In the U.S., roughly 14% of students enrolled in public school receive special education services. As families across the nation are grappling with how to teach their students from home, we wanted to look at the particular challenges parents of these students are facing. Here's what we heard.
My name is Erin Croyle. I live in Ithaca, New York. I have three children. I have a 9-year-old who has Down syndrome and ADHD and some other medical complexities that make it really, really difficult right now. My son, my oldest, requires a team of anywhere between 3 to 10 people at a time to help him learn. He's refusing to work. He's refusing to do any of the materials.
My name is Trisha Bermudez, and I live in Arver, New York, which is on the Rockaway Peninsula. And my son is Matthew. He is 7, and he was born with a rare chromosome deletion. So that puts him under a unique umbrella in the special education world, because he has one of his diagnoses is learning disability and global developmental delay. For me, it's more about his regression and what that looks like, and how much more work he will need once we come out of this pandemic.
My name is Angela Franco. I live in Rockville, Maryland. My son is Matthew Gulick. He's 11 years old. He has attended a special education program since he was 5 years old. I'm doing my best to keep it at home. You know, it's obviously not the same being at the school with a schedule, you know, with somebody that is not necessarily the parent, that is an outsider, that can be more objective.
My name is Corinne Raisler. I live in San Carlos, California, and I teach 2nd, 3rd, 4th, and 5th graders with mild to moderate disabilities. The assignments are relatively similar to what we were doing in the classroom, but dialed back a little bit. We've been told that we don't have to be teaching anything new.
I'm David Perry. I live in Shoreview, Minnesota, which is a suburb just north of the Twin Cities. And my son is 13. He's one of two kids. My daughter is 10. He has Down syndrome and is autistic. He's, I guess, what the professionals call functionally nonverbal. And we try to do the assignments that we can do, and we look for the ones that are well adapted and that seem to make sense. And we let a lot of things go, and we are letting a lot of things slide.
I try to do a schedule, and I try to get something to happen every day. And every day I feel like a failure. And I get emotional because I care so deeply about his education, but it's not possible.
For physical therapy, literally, I'm having to hold his arms to make sure he extends them, kind of coaching him on the other end of some things to kind of go on. But he's distracted, you know, because we're at home.
They're doing things online, but I put together like a mini maker in my house. So he has the tools, he has the glue, he has the screwdriver.
I used two pieces of wood.
So one day he came out with a trash picker that he made with a shoebox and a piece of wood. So he cut it and he put it on top of the shoebox, and I think it looked amazing. I was like, wow, I'm impressed with my son.
Thanks to Kid Museum, I made this.
He often requires a set of highly specific and intensive supports. I am not a trained special ed teacher. I'm not trained in providing him those supports. And if what I did all day was just sit with him and work on education, I think we could really accomplish a lot. But I'm not able to do that because I'm working from home.
I tell them every day that if they ever want to talk to me, that they can message me on the classroom and then we can have a one-on-one conversation. And I have done that with a student who was feeling very anxious and worried. And we talked about how she was feeling, and she was very sad that we weren't coming back to school.
This is much bigger than just saying, let's open schools. What does that game plan look like for our kids? And the plan that comes out of this needs to include our children aggressively.
We've been home for a month, and I think maybe I have sat him down and gotten him to engage maybe 3 times. And it's a little bit heartbreaking, but it also is, I just chalk it up to a win. Because you got to take what you can get, and hoping that that will lead to more success.
heartwarming and hard to hear at the same time. And we want to dig a little deeper into the challenges facing families with special needs students right now with Selene Almazan. She is the legal director for the Council of Parent Attorneys and Advocates. It's a nonprofit that aims to protect the legal and civil rights of children with disabilities. Selene Almazan, thank you very much. You've been doing this work for, what, more than 30 years. And you were telling us that one of the hardest things about what's going on right now is what these children are losing by not being in the classroom.
Yes, it's heartbreaking to listen to those families try to do what schools do every day with students with disabilities. So it really is heartbreaking. And I don't know what I would do being in their situation. Students with disabilities are losing out an enormous amount right now during this pandemic. And it is difficult to hear their struggles.
You pay a lot of attention to what school districts, what schools are required to do. Tell us just in general, what are schools required to do in working with these children? And then how is it different now that these children are out of the class?
Well, schools are required to provide a free, appropriate public education to children so they can make progress in their academic educational environment. They're supposed to address their the needs that the disabilities present, whether that's through academic, reading, writing, math. Other students need speech therapy, physical therapy, occupational therapy. And some students need more than what public schools can offer them and require private placement at public expense. And those are special education schools. So schools throughout the country pre-pandemic are providing many children with an appropriate education. The concern that we have had since the beginning of the school closures was what are schools going to do to address the needs of children with disabilities.
And realistically, how much of what these children were getting in the classroom? We heard one mother say her son requires anywhere from 3 to 10 people to work with him. How much of that can parents be realistically expected to do?
Well, I think it's hard because parents are also trying to work from home if they remain employed. So that's a plus that you're still employed. But it is difficult for families. Schools need to start where the IEP is, the Individualized Education Program, which is the roadmap that schools have to follow in order to educate a child. Many schools have implemented the distance learning plans. Those distance learning plans need to look at the goals on the IEP and continue to work on some of those goals in the distance learning plan. So if a child has needs in reading, if a child has needs in math, they should continue to address those needs through the distance learning plan. If a child has speech language needs and needs speech and language therapy, then that needs to be addressed. I think one of the mothers said that her child was receiving physical therapy electronically, but it requires her to manipulate his arms in order to participate in the physical therapy. And it is a lot for families. It is a lot.
We heard one of the mothers say she feels like a failure. What is your advice to parents who are watching this, listening to this, and feeling that this is more than they are capable of doing?
Well, from the outset, COPA has encouraged people to work together with their school districts. We're sort of all in this together, but also we've advised families to look at where a child was the day before school closed. What was the child able to do then academically or with their speech or with physical therapy? What was the child able to do? And then keep track either through video, either through data collection, either through looking at the assignments the child was able to complete pre-closure, what the child is able to complete during the closure instruction and document that so that when schools resume, they can come to the school and say, my child has regressed or my child has lost these skills. And this is where my child is now. We need to look at where he is now and start to program for him going forward, either by revising the IEP, by looking at new evaluations to see where a child is presently when they come back to school. It's hard when you're a parent of a child with a disability. I know that from my own experience. And what I do tell families is you just got to look at where you are on that day. And then tomorrow is another day. What parents of children with disabilities know, what we know as parents of children that have needs, is that every day is a new day. We also know that we have to work really hard at documenting for schools so that schools will know exactly what a child is going to need. Parents are a child's biggest advocate. You know your child the best. And the only thing that you can do between now and when school starts is continue to document what a child is doing now, what they were able to do before, so that when school reconvenes, you can give that information to the school.
Good advice, I am sure, for all these parents. We all need to give them as much support as we possibly can. Selene Almazan, joining us from Maryland. Thank you very much.
Thank you.